1 John chapter 3, verses 1 to 3. Behold what manner of love the Father has bestowed on us, that we should be called children of God. Therefore, the world does not know us, because it did not know him. Beloved, we are now the children of God, and it has not yet been revealed what we shall be. But we know that when he is revealed, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And everyone who has this hope in him purifies himself, just as he is pure.
Good morning. I would like to greet all the fathers out there. Happy Father's Day. Today is Father's Day Sunday. And not only the fathers, also those who are acting in as fathers. You may be a mother, you may be a grandfather, you may be an uncle, and you're doing the duty of a father. So happy Father's Day. This morning, we are going to look at a story found in Luke chapter 15. And this particular parable of Jesus has many titles to it. And as we're looking at the different versions, some would look at it. Now, by the way, this is found in Luke chapter 15, verses 11 on down. And for the more popular title, it would say the parable of the prodigal son. Others would say the parable of the lost son. Still others would say parable of the two lost sons. But there are a few translations out there that says the loving father. And I kind of like that ring. So since it is Father's Day, allow us to look at this story, to look at this parable in the viewpoint of a father. Let us start, and if you have your Bibles with you, please turn to Luke chapter 15, verse 11. Jesus continued, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, 'Father, give me my share of the estate.' So he divided his property between them." Now, before we go any farther, allow us to look at the context and the culture at the time. You see, this is a story told by Jesus, who is a Jew, a Hebrew, and the culture is Jewish culture. So if we will look at the Old Testament, and we will look at what it says there about this particular situations where a father is going to divide a property between his sons. If you can turn to Deuteronomy chapter 21, verse 15 to 17. Actually, this part was talking about how to divide a property. And I think if you're going to read this portion, there is some sort of a reference to Jacob. It's not really mentioned here, but it was talking about when a man has two wives, and we remember Jacob had two wives, Leah and Rachel, and one he didn't love so much, but the other one he loves very much. And there might be a tendency for the father to give more to the firstborn son of the wife that he loves. But it says here, if the unloved wife bears the first son, that means the very first born, the father still should give what is due to that son, even if he doesn't love the mother much more than the other one. So I would like to read verse 17 here, Deuteronomy 21:17. It says, he must acknowledge the son of his unloved wife as the firstborn by giving him a double share of all he has. That son is the first sign of his father's strength. The right of the firstborn belongs to him. So, in this situation now, when the father is saying, "Now we're going to divide," I mean, okay, it is not half. Like, he's got two sons. No, it's not 50-50. The division would be two-thirds to the eldest son and one-third to the younger one. So, even then, they proceeded with the transaction to divide the property and to give to the younger one what is due to him. But another thing that I need to point out is that normally it is not the younger son who needs to initiate this thing. It is the father who has the right to say, okay, I will now divide my property. Because as long as the father is living, he can always say, no, I will not give you anything. This property still belongs to me. I am still alive. And by this, I want to point out, one, because the father has properties to divide, he must have been a hard-working father. A father who really works hard so that he would be able to have property, who he will be able to feed his family, and to provide for the two sons. Another thing is, he is a father who looks to the future and the well-being of his sons. Because the reason why they were able to do it immediately, because he was already preparing. He knows already how much to give the younger one. He also knows how much to give the elder one. And everything was already prepared. It's not like, okay, we have to do it now and then do it haphazardly. No, everything has already been prepared. So he was very much concerned about the future of his sons. So immediately, he said, okay. And so he divided the property between them. But not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. Now, in verse 13, it says, not long after that, which means he was able to liquidate everything. Normally, when we look at in the preceding verse, it talks about the property. And it's not easy to sell a property. There was no internet marketing then. There was no eBay. So they probably would have to tell the neighbors that if they're interested to buy some of the land, because, you know, we want to convert that to money. Or the father could have said, son, I would pay you for your share. That way the farm will not get any smaller, because as soon as the son would sell it to another party, that would be a slice, a third. So you might have a property, you take out one third, you'll be left with two thirds, and you will produce less, and you have less grazing ground. So the father could have offered the son good value for those property. Since this is already yours, I have to buy it. Being a father and knowing that this father is a very loving father, he would not have taken advantage of the son. He would have probably even given a little bit more than the market value at the time. So then the son was able to get everything and then he left. Now what does the father think about this all this while? I would say this father is a very understanding father. He respects the son's decision. Another thing that I would like to show you, in the same chapter in Deuteronomy, chapter 21, right after the portion which I've read, in verse 18 to 21, it talks about a rebellious son. So allow me to just read this. If someone has a stubborn and rebellious son who does not obey his father and mother and will not listen to them when they discipline him, his father and mother shall take hold of him and bring him to the elders at the gate of his town. They shall say to the elders, "This son of ours is stubborn and rebellious. He will not obey us. He is a glutton and a drunkard." Then all the men of his town are to stone him to death. You must purge the evil from among you. All Israel will hear of it and be afraid. See, this is written down in Deuteronomy. So if the father would have said, no, you should not do that, and if the son would insist, that's the end of him. if the father was selfish, if the father was after only his own wealth, and he can easily go for this option and eliminate the son, and he will still retain everything. Property, money, and nothing would have been lost except for that wayward son. But no, he gave this son freedom to decide. So, this father truly has a loving heart. And so, he allowed the son to go. And the son went and squandered everything. Whew. And after he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. And he longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. What do you think would the father feel if he had seen his son in this condition at this moment? Of course, it was narrated that the son left for another country, faraway country, so the father didn't know what was happening. But if the father knew, and if the father was there and saw the son suffering like that, even with everything that he did, squandering the hard work of his father, living wildly, I'm sure the heart of that father will still bleed because he loved his son. He loved his son. And I cannot stress that enough, how the father loves the son. And when he came to his senses, this is a very important statement that we should take note of. When he came to his senses. In other words, he's not stupid. He is not dumb. He just refuses to acknowledge that fact. Because of all the things that was going on, he was busy having wild parties, spending money, just having fun, all the noise of the world coming to him. But brothers and sisters, these things could probably happen to us too. Remember, for every father out there, all of us are also sons. Is there such a thing as a father that didn't pass and was a son before? We were. And so in this case, the son didn't have anything, didn't have money, everybody left him, he has nothing to eat, there was famine. And the Jews, they don't like pig. It's dirty for them. And to be eating what the pig eats, wanting to eat what the pigs were eating, that's the lowest of all lows for a Jew. He has hit the bottom. And many of us would say, yeah, that's a good thing. Why? Because at least there's nowhere else to go except going up. I would say, yeah. But unless you know the direction to go up, you would still be wallowing down there. And good thing that this son came to his senses. He realized that how many of my father's hired men have food to spare, and here I am starving to death. He just realized that. He said, even my father's servants are eating better than me. Even my father's servants have roof above their heads. Even my father's servants' work is not as bad as this. And so he decided to come home. And when he was coming home, he was thinking to himself, what should I say? What should I say to my father? And he said, okay, this is what I'm going to say. Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men. And that's what he was thinking. Now, what prompted him to go home? What made him decide to go home? Ah, because he knows his father is a forgiving father. Would you go home to somebody who's got maybe a knife or a bolo waiting for you? I don't think so. You know, it is because he knows the nature of his father, that his father is a loving and understanding father and a forgiving father at that. So this reminds me of CPR. You know what CPR is? I think many of those who are in the medical profession know cardiopulmonary resuscitation, the CPR. And this procedure has saved a lot of people. But I'm also thinking about using that mnemonic to describe the Father's love. The Father's love is constant. It does not change. It's the same yesterday, today, forever. That love will always be there. The Father's love is patient. Patient. He will not say, "Ah, took so long for him to come home. I give up on him." No, the Father does not give up on you. Father's love is patient love. R, the Father's love is ready to receive you in his embrace when you come home. That's the kind of Father that we have too, our Heavenly Father. And so what happened to this son? While he was still a long way off, see, his father saw him and was filled with compassion. And he ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. Kissed him. I know he smells. I know he stinks. Coming out of feeding those swine. But his father just ran. And what does this say about the father? The father was constantly on the lookout, day in, day out. Every time he was out there, he was looking up the road. Maybe today, maybe today, maybe today my son will come home. And finally, he did come home, and the father ran. And the son was about to say, "Father, I have sinned against heaven. I am not worthy." You know, the speech that he was preparing. But the father said to his servants, "Quick, bring the best robe, put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet." And I've gone through this story many times, told to me since I was a boy in Sunday school. But what strikes me are the three things that are mentioned here. Best robe, a ring on his finger, and sandals on his feet. And you know what these three things remind me of? See, when the father saw the state of his son, I don't know, maybe he was half naked, you know, without any shirt on, and he was barefoot. Probably he was just dressed in rags, we don't know. Filthy. And so he got the robe and covered him with that robe. Because he does not like to remember. Every time he see the state of his son, looking at his son like that, he would remember it is the act of disobedience, of being rebellious, that has brought him to this condition. But I don't want to remember that. And so he covered the son. And this reminds me of a verse in Isaiah chapter 43, verse 25. In Isaiah 43:25, the Lord said, "I, even I, am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake and remembers your sin no more." Now, we're not saying that our God is a forgetful God. No. He is not a forgetful God. He just states that, "I choose not to remember your sins." In the same way, the father in this parable says, "I don't want to remember that very bad decision that you made. I'm going to cover you. I'm going to cover that and blot that out so no one can see the shame. And he gave him a ring. And I remember when I graduated way, way back college, and people would have their class rings made. And so there were people who were wearing rings because of their profession. There are also, you know, people wearing rings because of their affiliation with a fraternity, whatever. This ring is the ring of identity. This is the family ring. And once that ring was placed on his finger, it's just like saying, it does not matter how he looks, this man is my son. This man belongs to my family. And if there is protection being done in this household, that son is protected as well. And so this is the identity, this ring given to him. And reminds us of 1 John chapter 3. Behold, 1 John chapter 3 verse 1. Behold what manner of love the Father has bestowed on us, that we should be called children of God. We are now children of God. The sonship is there. The Father has restored to this son his identity, that he is my son, I am his father. The sandal came next. And again, I would relate it to a verse in Psalm 91, and he says, for he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. From blotting out the wrong decisions of your life, by blotting out the mistakes that we've done, God has conferred on you your identity, that you are a son of God. You are a child of God. And together with that comes his promise that he will command his angels to protect you. That sandal signifies that he doesn't even need to walk barefoot anymore. And he doesn't need to hurt his foot because now he is a son. Amazing, isn't it? Now, I know that the story still continues after that, but I just want to focus on that. The focus on the Father's love. The Father who loves his son. Brothers and sisters, you might probably find yourself in the same state, hitting rock bottom, thinking that nobody loves you, thinking that nobody cares. God cares. God cares enough to send his son Jesus Christ. And through that cross, in dying on that cross, giving you a way out. All you need to do is to submit yourself to him. Consider him as your master and Lord and Savior. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for your love. Thank you for your great, great love. A love that is constant, patient, and ready to receive us. Lord, we praise you for what you have done. We thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, for coming here to take our sins away, to take our place on that cross. Lord, I pray and continue to pray for the safety of everyone during this time. We are not out of it yet. And infections are still jacking up the numbers. And I know, Lord, that we are still on uncertain times. But we know that we have a God who has given us a promise of protection. We have a God who has embraced us as his son. And we have a God who will not remember the mistakes that we've done when we come before you and consider you as our Lord and Master. Lord, be with each and every one. We pray for those who are not feeling well. There might be some who are sick. I pray, Lord, that you extend your healing hand upon them. Restore them. Grant them health. And I pray, Lord, for protection for everyone that is going through this crisis, especially in their work, in their businesses. I pray, Lord, for your leading and help in that area, that they will be guided to make the right decisions at this time. All glory and honor be unto you. We praise you and we thank you. And now, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love, everlasting love of the Heavenly Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and forever. Amen.